My name is Catherine Onenson, and I am the lead Global Voices Metcalf intern, as well as an International House alum. On behalf of the residents and staff, it is my pleasure to welcome you all tonight to International House and to this evening's program. The 2016 annual public lecture featuring Kathleen Neal Cleaver is presented by the Center for the Study of Race, Politics, and Culture, with support from the International House Global Voices Performing Arts and Lecture Series, the Center for Identity Plus Inclusion, the Office of Multicultural Student Affairs, the Office of Civic Engagement's UChicago Engages Series, and the Black Panther Party, Illinois Chapter History Project. I hope all of you will return to International House throughout the rest of the 2015-2016 academic year to attend other Global Voices lectures and performances. Global Voices public programming advances cross-cultural understanding and offers opportunities for civic discourse on community, national, and world affairs through music and dance performances, films, lectures, conferences, and roundtable discussions. You can find information about these programs on the literature table at the front entrance. Please make sure to sign up for a mailing list in order to receive announcements about all of our exciting upcoming events. Now, I am very pleased to introduce you to Michael C. Dawson, who will introduce the rest of tonight's program. Michael C. Dawson is the John D. MacArthur Distinguished Service Professor of Political Science in the College at the University of Chicago. His research interests have included the development of quantitative models of African-American political behavior, identity, and public opinion, the political effects of urban poverty, and African-American political ideology. More recently, he has combined his quantitative work with work in political theory. His first two books, Behind the Mule, Race and Class in African-American Politics, and Black Visions, The Roots of Contemporary African-American Political Ideologies, won multiple awards, including the latter winning the prestigious Ralph Bunche Award from the American Political Science Association. Recent books include Not in Our Lifetimes, The Future of Black Politics, and Blacks in and Out of the Left. He is, with Lawrence Bobo, the founding co-editor of the journal, The Du Bois Review, as well as being the founding and current director of the Center for the Study of Race, Politics, and Culture at the University of Chicago. Please join me in welcoming Professor Dawson.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Oh, you can do better than that. Let me try one more time. Good evening.
Good evening.
Thank you. On behalf of the Center for the Study of Race, Politics, and Culture, I welcome to our annual public lecture. We are thrilled and honored to have as our speaker Kathleen Neal Cleaver. Kathleen Neal Cleaver was to me and many other students of my generation an inspiration as we were trying to find our way into and through the Black Liberation Movement. And the CSRPC is excited to be part of the discussion tonight. We live once again in a time of open and mobilized racism and white supremacy, manifested in increasingly violent and vile verbal and physical attacks on Black people and people of color in this country. We also live in a time when young Black people are rebuilding and revitalizing Black movements for justice, equality, and liberation. To build a truly just society, we must rebuild a community of vigorous debate, planning, action, and accountability. We must rebuild Black movements that embrace an activist version of politics that neither relies on nor ignores electoral politics. All sectors of the Black community, particularly the most disadvantaged sectors, including the Black poor and Black youth, have to be included in all phases of Black politics and debate, including the leadership. Social movements and political engagement have been a longstanding focus of much of the research and teaching at the center, which includes research on public health and health disparities, racial conflict and cooperation, urban politics, as well as an active urban arts and media program. This has been as part of our 20th anniversary year, which has focused on the contributions of the study of race and ethnicity globally, can continue to make intellectual inquiry and making a better world. I also would like to thank our course co-sponsors in the International House Global Voices series, the Center for Identity Plus Inclusion and the Office of Multicultural Affairs, the Office of Civic Engagement, UChicago Engages Series, and the Black Panther Party, Illinois Chapter History Project. I most especially want to thank the staff of the CSRPC, particularly Tracy Matthews, Dara Essien, and Julius Jones, and our volunteers, without whom this event would not have been possible. And most of all, I want to thank Kathleen Neal Cleaver and this audience who has come out to participate in this event. I now want to introduce one of our student leaders on this campus, who will in turn introduce the main speaker for tonight. Cassette Hampton is a third-year undergraduate student studying public policy and human rights at the University of Chicago. It's one of many young black people ages 18 to 35 doing crucial work, organizing work in the Chicago chapter of the Black Youth Project 100. Cosette defines herself using Alice Walker's term as a radical womanist who's inherently pro-black, pro-prison and police abolition, pro-Jesus, and pro-queer. Her adoption of these identities inspired her to use research, organizing, and academic scholarship to fight anti-blackness, poverty, police violence, and systemic oppression. She looks up to the Black Panther Party and the work of black women within it, like Kathleen Cleaver, for direction, and she continues to fight for black liberation today. Please join me in welcoming Cassette Hampton.
Good evening. I want to extend a big thank you to Professor Dawson and Tracy Matthews for the introduction, and to the CSRPC for the opportunity to introduce a powerful woman who myself and many other young black organizers in Chicago across the country look up to, Ms. Kathleen Cleaver. Kathleen Cleaver has committed most of her life not only to the fight for liberation for black people, but has also highlighted in many spaces where it was ignored the impact of systemic oppression, racism, and sexism against black women. In 1966, Cleaver dropped out of Barnard College to work full-time at the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee's New York office, also known as SNCC, until she moved to the national office in Atlanta, where she met her former husband, Eldridge Cleaver, at a black student conference she was organizing. She became activated in the Black Panther Party and served as the communications secretary from 1967 to 1971, and always pushed for some of the most radical actions that led to much of the foreground today on battling anti-blackness. She was actually the first woman to be appointed to the Black Panther Central Committee. After returning from exile with Eldridge in 1975, Kathleen has devoted herself to freeing imprisoned freedom fighters like Mumia Abu-Jamal and educating others through a powerful lens of racial justice. Cleaver graduated summa cum laude with a BA in history from Yale College in 1984, and in 1989, she received a JD from Yale Law School. Cleaver joined the faculty of Emory University Law School in 1992 and also taught at various institutions like the African American Studies Department at Yale College and the Benjamin Cardozo School of Law. She has published many well-known essays and books like The Memories of Love and War, her continuing memoir, and in Critical Race Feminism, The Promise of Multiculturalism, and The Black Panther Party Reconsidered. She was also featured in the documentary The Black Panthers, Vanguard of the Revolution, one of my personal favorites. Cleaver co-founded and produced the International Black Panther Film Festival, and since 2000 has served as the co-director of the Human Rights Research Fund. Today, she also lectures in legal and civil rights history at Emory University School of Law and speaks widely across the U.S. at public forums and universities like ours. The University of Chicago thanks Kathleen Cleaver for joining us tonight, and we are eager to hear from her. I want to encourage folks in the age of social media to connect with each other and allow people who aren't here to engage in the conversation by tweeting using the hashtag #YouShyKCleaver and tagging at CSRPC. That's spelled hashtag U, the letter U, C-H-I-K, Cleaver, and tagging CSRPC. I want to invite Kathleen up with a praise to our elders and ancestors that an organization I'm a part of, BYP 100, the Black Youth Project 100, often uses. Kathleen Cleaver was a freedom fighter who taught us how to fight. We gon' fight all day and night until we get it right. Thank you so much.
Thank you for your very warm, passionate Chicago welcome. They don't clap like this at Emory. Well, I'll just get into it. I'll start my talk. I might not finish it, but I'll end it. I think that the main reason I was invited to come to speak at this center is because of my involvement with revolutionary movements during the 1960s, most specifically the Black Panther Party. And I say revolutionary movements, they didn't all stay revolutionary all at the same time. But we started out that way, that was our goal, and I'm sure there's some of you who know exactly what I mean, who've had that experience. They start out being a revolutionary, or actually, I didn't start out being a revolutionary, I started out being a student who was very, very impressed with the activism in Albany, Georgia, of black young high school girls like myself. So that's not being a revolutionary. That's being a person who sees somebody challenging racism in a very dangerous way, in a very dangerous place, like Albany, Georgia, is still dangerous. And I was very impressed, and I wanted to do that. I never actually got to do anything in Albany, but I did get to do something in Alameda County, which is much less scary than Albany, Georgia. But my involvement with the Black Panther Party happened quite suddenly. At the time that I first went to California, I was living in Atlanta. I was working at the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee's national office. That space at 360 Nelson Street now is an empty lot, and I drive past it a lot of times on my way back and forth in Atlanta. It's so strange. It tells you how much things can change. There used to be in that green space over there that is now being yuppified. Any of you been to Atlanta and eaten at Pascal's?
Yeah.
Well, you wouldn't believe what they've got in place of Pascal's. So that one they don't have, and there's a new yuppie one right past where Nelson Street is, actually, where I drive past. So I always see it. That's not Pascal's. anyway, there was a very large brick warehouse on that spot, and that was the headquarters, national headquarters of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, which is a wealthy millionaire in Chicago had bought for us. We activists in Atlanta, we'd hitchhike to work because we didn't have cars. SNCC had no funds left at that time to pay any salaries. So the people who were left in Atlanta, this is 1967 I'm talking about, Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee started in 1960, so this is 7 years down the line. They were a very determined group. We would work all day and sometimes all night and for no pay. The only thing that the office could give us, well, first of all, it was a place to work and the equipment, but also a Watts line. And you probably don't even know what that is. You have to be over 50 to know what a Watts line is. But it's a phone that you could call all over the country for one price. And so we had to have our Watts line because people had to be able to call the office, and we had to be able to call people because people's lives were on the line. And to this day, if I see the sign that says Prattville, it's a town in Alabama, it gives me chills because, not because I've ever been to Prattville, but because one night in Atlanta, Stanley Wise and Stokely Carmichael and someone else was in Prattville in Alabama, and the building they were in or the home they were in was surrounded by the Klan, and we didn't know what was going to happen to them. And they didn't either. So we just stayed on the phone. Nothing actually happened, but it was scary. And those kind of intimidating things, you remember them. They mark you. They mark the place. If I ever hear the word Prattville, I get upset. but I wanted to be in the movement, and SNCC was the pinnacle of what I thought was important to do. Ever since I read a newspaper story about these high school girls in Albany who had protested racist conditions and the denial of the right to vote. They weren't even old enough to vote, but they wanted their parents to be able to vote. Because their bravery just blew my mind. Standing up against Georgia racists in a nonviolent protest, heading off to jail for their actions, and then when they went to jail, they were singing and clapping. So this is kind of, you know, like, what's up with this? How many of you have been to jail? Did you sing when you went to jail? I don't think so. I've been to a lot of jails, but not on the inside. I ran on the outside to get people out, and I don't sing then, you know. So all I had wanted to do in my life at this point, I was there, I was in Atlanta, I was in the movement. But I later discovered, after I got there, this movement was falling apart. The organization was in shambles. In the wake of a call for Black Power, which was galvanizing an entire generation, and many of you galvanized are here. Many of you who became galvanized by that call are in this room. There was a change in the staff and practices of the organization. The new idea that Stokely Carmichael, later Kwame Ture, was that white members of SNCC would work in the white community and the black members would stay in the black community. Carmichael described that as how we were going to be implementing Black Power, one of the ways that we would implement Black Power. SNCC had enjoyed the support of numerous white donors by the time I had reached Atlanta in January 1967, and many other very wealthy people, including Harriet Belafonte. But that was lost by the time I got there. As far as I learned, it was because SNCC had reproduced a story that was in some, or maybe they did the drawings. It was a story, it was like cartoons about Israel. And it was about Moshe Dayan. It was about dropping bombs in Palestine that looked like toys. And the little children would come and pick up the toys and then it would explode. And so our research project was revealing that, and that came along with Black Power. So a lot of people didn't even like the concept of Black Power. I think Roy Wilkins said something negative. Martin Luther King actually just said, it's an unfortunate choice of words. But he didn't say it was a bad thing. But we loved it. And most of the kids who were watching the movement in the cities in the north and other cities who were young, they loved Black Power. They loved the fist. They loved the idea of challenge. It's exciting. It's because they had grown up watching on television, the demonstrations, and seeing black kids get beat up, seeing the police beat them up. And then in 63, when I graduated from high school, that was Birmingham. There was a lot of people beat up in Birmingham. And so when you're a young high school kid, and you watch black people get beat up, and they don't fight back, it makes you feel bad. And those are the kind of kids who joined the Black Panther Party. They didn't feel bad in the Black Panther Party. Because we didn't let people beat us up like that. It was not part of the program. We were the Black Panther Party for self-defense. Okay. I was working when I first came to Atlanta. I had been in SNCC in New York, but then I ended up going down to the national headquarters, and there I was working to organize a student conference, which was supposed to take place over the Easter weekend of 1967 at Fisk. But by the time the conference actually materialized that March, SNCC was not welcome on the Fisk campus because Vanderbilt was having another program later in April. Our conference was in March. Vanderbilt had invited Strom Thurmond. They had invited I can't think of the famous poet, the one who said, in New York. They had invited Martin Luther King, and unfortunately, they had invited Stokely Carmichael. And the Tennessee legislature said, there is no way Stokely Carmichael is coming to Nashville because he will bring violence. The students at Vanderbilt said, we're a private school, you can't tell us what to do. He's on our program. So the whole town was all upset because Stokely Carmichael was going to bring violence to Nashville, which is where our conference was taking place in March. So I was one of the coordinators of the conference, but the two men who were actually in the SNCC office who had planned it, George Ware and Ernest Stevens, were away organizing somewhere else. And they were driving back to Nashville to get there just in time for the conference, but they got arrested for inciting a riot. The riot had already started, at outside some club because the Nashville police couldn't wait for Stokely Carmichael to come and start the violence. So they started it all up, and there was a riot outside a club. I think it was called the Dewdrop Inn or something. I can't remember. I wasn't there right at that time. But my comrades, George Ware and Ernest Stevens, were arrested on the way to Nashville for inciting a riot. This is Southern justice. Or maybe this is Chicago justice, too. Yeah. I don't know if it's American justice, but it certainly is racist justice. Okay. So our conference had a theme. It was said, liberation will come from a black thing. And this was based on something written by our guiding spirit, Jim Foreman. But Stokely was the chairman of SNCC. And they were convinced if the chairman of SNCC named Stokely Carmichael, who made the call for black power, showed up in Nashville, there was going to be a riot. Well, they had the riot before he got there. And there was quite a bit of shooting. There was only one story written about that uprising in Nashville. It was in, it wasn't Jet, it was the other magazine. No, there's a small magazine, Negro Digest. Yes, they covered it. And maybe Jet did also, I'm sorry. But it was just a picture of all the kids who got arrested, all the students who got arrested after police had shot in their dorms. One person was paralyzed. Anyway, that was how it ended. But at the beginning, before we ever got the conference starting, I'm at the apartment of Fred Brooks, who was the leader of the campus SNCC group. We had support groups on various campuses that the students there hosted, and they would host events and they would raise money. They would also relate to us, like they would come, if they live close enough, come from their campus down to the SNCC office, use our printing press, start events, invite people to get your speeches. So we had supporters, student supporters around the country from different campuses, and that's who was coming to our conference at Eastern. And so, we had planned it for the Easter weekend because the student participants wouldn't have school then. And so they could all come down to Nashville and we could, you know, discuss programs and activism, et cetera. But it just so happened, the weekend, which was Easter, of our conference, was a snowfall along the East Coast. So all the airports were closed. So none of the speakers we had invited, other than Eldridge Cleaver, came. He came from San Francisco. They didn't have snow in San Francisco. And I was there typing, retyping the agenda because we had to not use Fisk buildings. We could only use Father Woodruff, Jim Woodruff's church, which is one room. So we didn't really need the same agenda that we had. And I was retyping the agenda, and someone brought Eldridge Cleaver from the airport, and I had read about him, and I had read things he had written. I don't think I'd actually seen a picture of it. So I was very, very impressed with what he had written. But then he was very tall. Whatever the door frame was, he came in and he just stood there in the door frame, which later I learned that's what convicts do. You come and stand at the door till you're allowed to enter. You can't, I mean, he'd been in prison 9 years. He's used to standing in the door. So, I look up, this really tall, very tall man with yellow skin and high cheekbones, kind of slanted. He had no expression on his face, none. So I didn't know that's what prisoners look like. They don't have any expression. They hide their expressions. How would I know? I don't think I'd even seen a prisoner at that point before. Anyway, so he said it was love at first sight. Oh, I looked and looked back, you know. but he was our only speaker. And he kept asking me to do things. Would you get me this? Would you get me that? Then I'd get it, and he didn't seem to be interested. I didn't understand what he was doing. A friend of mine said, yes, he was stalking you. I didn't know that men did that. Well, I didn't know too much of anything like that. SNCC didn't pay us salaries, but the organization did keep the Watts line, long-distance telephone service, and electricity, and the apartment where all the staff of the campus program lived, who happened to be all connected to Tuskegee Institute in some way. It was in an inexpensive neighborhood, and it was a place that was handed down from one staff member to another. The previous occupant had been John Lewis. But when Stokely became the chairman, he didn't want to live there. So he had other options. And so the people who lived there were the campus program staff, George Ware, Ernest Stevens, Samuel Schutz, and me. And we were all tied to Tuskegee in some way. My father had agreed that he would support me for 1 year because I told him I wasn't learning anything in college. He should give me the tuition he paid Barnard, and I would go join SNCC, and I would learn something. He did it. He said, okay, I'll do it for 1 year. And I think he did this because my family was sort of split. My mother and he were divorcing if they hadn't already divorced. He was working in the Philippines. She was living in Washington. I was in school in New York. And I think he wanted to, you know, do something to kind of keep communication going. And I was very, very excited about this. And he said, okay, I'll pay you the Barnard tuition for 1 year. But after the end of the year, you have to go back to school. So every month I would get a check for $100. And I would use that to cover our expenses since we had no salary. So I was I'd raised money for SNCC at the beginning. My father was a professor of sociology when I was a little kid. He brought us, his family, me and my brother and my mother, to Tuskegee Institute in 1947, where he'd been invited to teach and invited to run something called the Rural Life Council, which was economic development for the rural sharecroppers and farmers in Tuskegee. We left Dallas in one of those square-looking big cars, the 1940s. I think it was called a Nash. Anybody here know what a Nash is? Yeah, okay. And we drove to Tuskegee, which became our home until he decided he was leaving. He decided he would leave, not because he didn't like his job, but because somebody else was made president of the institute and he thought he was more qualified, so he left. And he went to work for the Foreign Service as in the same field, rural community development. And he was sent to, Ford Foundation sent him to India, and then he came back, and then the State Department hired him. And so in the 50s, we moved to India. And then after that, we lived in other places where he was doing rural community development. And so I was outside of the United States from the time I was 9 up until I was about a sophomore and junior in high school, was it 16, something like that. So it was a good time in my life. I lived away from the United States. I lived in countries that had their own government. India was run by Indians. Filipinos ran the Philippines. Liberians ran Liberia. We lived in Sierra Leone, and the British still ran it, but they were becoming independent. So I was in the place where countries had become, brown people had become independent of Europeans and were running their lives, and so that's my norm. It was a good thing, because that was not the norm in Alabama. But I left Alabama and left those norms behind. So I could never accept white supremacy. That didn't make any kind of sense, particularly if you're living in India. Lord have mercy. My father also, I think part of the reason he was willing to agree to support me is because when he was much younger, he'd been a civil rights activist in Texas. He was on the faculty at Wiley College, but he worked with the people who were challenging the all-white primary, which is actually pretty dangerous, very dangerous. And there were people who were killed in that movement. And in SNCC, in Tuskegee, there was a student activist named Sammy Young, somebody I grew up with. Although he was Catholic, he went to a different school than I went to. But I knew Sammy. Sammy was the most effervescent, cheerful, upbeat kid you want to know. He'd gone into the Navy, and after he finished, he came back to Tuskegee as a student. So he's a little older, and he was working in SNCC, and the SNCC organization on campus was something called TILE, Tuskegee Institute Advancement League, which is also where George Ware worked and Ernest Stevens worked. And so these are the people whom I plugged into in New York, because they had, George Ware and Ernest Stevens had left Tuskegee and come to New York. We were in New York when Sammy Young was murdered. And so George Ware, who was a graduate student, and Sammy was younger, he felt really devastated. Well, first of all, he was devastated. But secondly, I think he felt some level of responsibility because he was a leader of TILE, Tuskegee Institute Advancement League. Sammy was one of the activists, very, very, very energetic, and he went to Alabama, worked with the Black Panther Party there. He went to Mississippi, worked for the Freedom Democrat. He was learning, and so he was murdered by a white racist gas station attendant over an argument over, this is 66, an argument over which bathroom we're going to use. So down in the South, they have four bathrooms now because they had white ladies, white gentlemen, white ladies, colored women, and colored men. So they argued over which bathroom he was going to go to, and he ended up shot in the back. And when I look at the pictures, see thousands of kids from Tuskegee on the green. They wanted them to pull down the Confederate statue after he was killed. And they tried and tried and tried and tried, but they couldn't pull it down, so they just marked it up and put Black Power, Free, you know, Sammy Young, and, you know, it's just, so this is a fervent time that I'm getting involved with the SNCC, and the SNCC led me to the Black Panther Party, and that made me see I was in a revolution. Many, many years later, while we were living in Paris, I saw, this is in the mid-70s, I saw an interview on French television with Alexander Solzhenitsyn, who's a Russian writer. And he said something that I never forgot. I don't remember what the question was, but he said, revolution may bring justice, and it may not. And I said, I never thought about that. I thought there was a direct relationship between revolution and justice. When you live in injustice, if you have a revolution, that's to bring justice. Well, Solzhenitsyn had another story. And so back in 1967, that was not even a possibility. The revolution we envisioned, the revolutionary we talked about, the revolution we studied how to accomplish was a revolution to bring about democracy, economic, political, social democracy, justice for oppressed and exploited black people suffering. We believe that our revolution could replace a regime of property rights with a regime of human rights. So that tells you how young we were. We still want that. Our politics in SNCC were becoming more international and more radical than they had been in the era of the sit-ins and the marches. In SNCC, we were the first generation of black power organizers. And I don't think everybody really knew exactly what it was. Stokely came back from a visit to California. California was a place where we raised money a lot to support SNCC. There were a lot of supporters there, and they would have friends of SNCC. And I'm sure they had friends of SNCC here. Some of you might know, might have even been in friends of SNCC and helped raise money for them. But we were moving away from that commitment to only nonviolent protest and racial integration in the Black Power movement. We were thinking of more like for liberation from colonialism, armed struggle, which seemed to me very remote when I first heard about it. But after you hear it longer and longer, it begins to make sense, particularly when the police are after you and want to kill you. I happened to be on a panel in Harlem for the documentary film Black Panthers, Vanguard of the Revolution. And there was a panel of people who were going to discuss it after people had seen it. I was sitting beside Erica Huggins. So how many of you have ever seen this film? Well, Erica is the woman at the beginning who talks about how the Panther Party is like what blind men describe an elephant. Depends on which part they get. And so I don't know her that well. She was always in LA when I was in the Bay Area. We don't connect that frequently. So I asked her, we're on this panel, I said, Erica, when you came into the party, did you think you were going to live through it? She said, no. I don't think too many of us did think that we would live through it. But that wasn't the point. We weren't here to live through it. We were here to change the world. And we're going to do it regardless. So we wanted democracy, real democracy, economic democracy, political democracy, justice for oppressed, and we believed that we could accomplish it. I never worked so hard in my life as I did the first week I went to SNCC. Jim Foreman had a conference, a session, and he published a pamphlet. Some of you might have seen this. It was called Rock Bottom. We had all these discussions, and my job was to take notes, write down all the things we said, and then transcribe the notes, and then type it up, and then edit it, give it to Jim Foreman. But Rock Bottom was what he saw. He had been a history teacher here in Chicago before he came down to Atlanta. And he made us understand that revolution would be a protracted struggle to transform an oligarchic structure of this society. He would give long speeches, beginning with the 14th Amendment, which, if you ever read the 14th Amendment, you'll see it still hasn't been implemented. Right. Particularly the section about the states that don't endorse it will have their representation in Congress reduced by the number of people that they don't register allowed to vote. Oh, they ain't never done that one. It's on the 14th Amendment, it's part of the Constitution, but the places of the country where they wanted to implement it wouldn't do it. I think they call that states' rights. So, so Jim Foreman had come up with the theme of our conference, and some of the students came from all over, from Berkeley, from Cornell. In fact, I'll never forget some of the students who had been at our conference. A few months later, we saw pictures of them coming out of Straight Hall with rifles up at Cornell. Those are the African American. What was it called? The name of their organization? African American Students, something. You know, so this was an explosion of enthusiasm. This is the beginning of my training as a revolutionary, working in the SNCC campus program. We set up a summer project in Mississippi for the summer. And then once that was done, I went to visit Eldridge, because by this time, we had fallen in love. He kept trying to get my attention in Nashville. It didn't work that well. I had to leave. I had to go to a wedding soon. So I said, I've got to go back to Atlanta. And when I told him I had to go back to Atlanta, he asked Fred Brooks, who was our coordinator, how are we getting there? And he said, well, we have to get a car. He says, I have a car. He did. He had a rental car. The problem he didn't tell us is that he was on parole. And he had no business leaving the area of where he was given permission to go. He didn't bother to tell us that. In fact, a middle-aged white lady came walking across the campus right before we were supposed to go. And he said, this is my lawyer. She scowled at him. Why? She was his fiancée, according to her. But he didn't bother to introduce her as his fiancée. And I didn't know. I didn't know she was this fiancée. How would I know? And why would I know? And why would I care? I mean, really. So we went off to Atlanta in Eldridge's car. Fred needed to do some printing. I needed to get ready to go to the wedding. And Eldridge was still trying to get my attention, which he did succeed in getting after I beat him at a chess game. And then we fell in love. I fell in love. He was already in love. And then he had to go back to California. So the only way I could see him, when he got back to California, he could not leave the city limits of San Francisco. That's what they did to parolees. They could tell you this, that, and the other. Because he'd been down to Nashville, and a riot actually had happened in Nashville. And they had been shooting back and forth in the dorms with the police, et cetera, after our conference ended. And so he left, and he was not allowed to go anywhere, not outside the city limits of San Francisco. So when I came to visit him, I had to stay in the city limits of San Francisco. And then I ended up having to go back to finish my work in SNCC. And we were in love, calling back and forth, talking, sending letters back and forth. I wasn't quite sure. You don't have to know when you're 21. You don't really have to know all the details of how it's going to work out. In fact, you don't even know that you have to know it's going to work out. So I get a call from him, and he says, you've got to come out here. Huey Newton, who was one of the founders of the Black Panther Party, had been wounded and almost killed in a shootout in Oakland, pre-dawn shootout with a very well-known, brutal policeman named John Fry, who had stopped him after he left a party. It was early dawn, like 4:30, 5 o'clock in the morning. He had stopped him. Some altercation had come about, and long story short, Hilliard, the policeman, didn't know what happened. Fry is dead. Huey is wounded, bullet in his stomach, and then he survives and gets charged with death penalty crime of killing a policeman. And so when I get out to California the next time to visit Eldridge, it's a very somber occasion, and he takes me right away to a meeting. The Panthers don't have an office. Bobby Seale's in jail after the Sacramento visit. Some people have kind of disappeared. So we go to a meeting that in an apartment that a professor at Merritt College had let us use to meet. And I think it was Reginald and Sherwin Forte, who were teenagers, Orleander Harrison, who was a teenager, Emory Douglas, who's just a little bit older, and Eldridge, and me. That's the Black Panther Party, and I'm not in it, I'm in SNCC. In fact, there's some some images, because I was helping to raise money, and it said Kathleen Cleaver, 360 Nelson Street. You know, I wasn't even living. So here we are, this is what I want you to understand. This is the group that sits up and decides we have to do something, we have to make sure Huey doesn't go to the gas chamber. So having been in SNCC, I suggest, how about a demonstration? He said, we don't like marching. But we'll march for Huey. So the young men and their girlfriends from San Francisco State came to our apartment. We wrote up little placards, and we held a demonstration outside the courthouse when Huey Newton first went to appear for his arraignment. And I started learning all these words about various procedures, and I was very incensed when they said, the people versus, I said, the people? Who is the people? We're the people. We're the ones in the audience of the people. They're the state, but the state calls itself the people. So the case is the people versus Huey Newton. And Huey Newton made a decision. He didn't have to make this decision, but he decided he wanted to be tried as the Minister of Defense of the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense. Now, this is in 1967. This is a time when there's rising, uprisings, rebellions, riots. Every time a policeman kills a kid in a black neighborhood, and that was frequently in the summertime. And it was always, without fail, the policemen were okay because it was justifiable homicide. But it's not okay if you're Huey Newton and the policeman's dead. You know, that's the gas chamber. That's the death penalty offense. So this is what we were looking at. And nobody, they loved Huey. They admired him. They really, really were... You know, it was a devastating moment. Stokely, I remember coming back from California to Atlanta, and he had this scroll that Huey Newton had signed, and it made Stokely Field Marshal east of the Mississippi for the Black Liberation Movement. Oh, he was very, very proud of that. Well, the Black Panther Party had been created by Bobby Seale and Huey Newton. Bobby had a job at one of the poverty programs, North Oakland Poverty Program, and they had typed out the program and typed out everything and chosen officers, but they didn't have a name. They had an organization concept, but they didn't have a name. So Huey read a pamphlet that John Hewlett in Lowndes County had written about his campaign for sheriff. And the party that he was running on was called the Black Panther Party. Why? Because Alabama's Democratic Party had a white rooster on their logo. for the Democratic Party. It was red and had a rooster with a ribbon in its mouth. It said, "White supremacy for the right." So Lowndes County Freedom Organization created their poster, which was also red, but had a Black Panther on it. They said, "The Black Panther will eat up the white rooster." So Huey wanted to use the name Black Panther, but they had already used it in Lowndes County. So he wrote a letter to SNCC and asked if they could have permission to use the name the Black Panther Party, but it wasn't for an electoral organization, and it would be for a group called the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense, and he got permission. So we were tied closely together, probably more closely than we knew. Stokely and Rap Brown were the ones, the key organizers in Lowndes County, and they were the people in SNCC who were most like and closest to Black Panthers. And for those of you who have never heard of Rap Brown, H. Rap Brown, who was Minister of Justice for the Black Panther Party briefly, while Stokely was Prime Minister of the African American Nation very briefly when we had a coalition together. Rap Brown is actually still alive. He's in prison. He got a life sentence for supposedly having killed a policeman in a shootout in Atlanta, very close to the mosque and the neighborhood where he lived. Except one of the problems with the case is that the physical description of the shooter doesn't match Rap Brown. And the shooter has periodically confessed from whatever jail he's in that he did it, but then he retracts. So I was a character witness in the trial in Atlanta. I think it was 1999, or maybe it was 2001. I remember because it was after 9/11, and the trial was set at that time, very close to the 9/11, and the judge moved it. She said, no, we're not. But Jamil Alameen, now that's his name, was willing to come to court full Muslim regalia, you know, white hood and long dark robe. He's proud to be a Muslim. But his lawyers didn't want him to go to court, and even the judge didn't want him to come to court like that. And so this stuff, it never ends. This is what I want you to understand. This is a movement for justice, for change. We use rebellion, we use revolution, we use social justice, we use demonstrations, we use other techniques. And guess what? We have to turn around and use it all again, generation after generation. So far, at least I've observed that. Now, I'm not going to observe too many more generations, even though I have 15 grandchildren. I don't think I will observe them in their maturity. So hopefully, so we thought, we would have a revolution that would bring about justice. What we have is a revolution that brought about repression, that brought about our annihilation, and an enhanced repression, enhanced policing. We were opposed to what we saw during the era of Vietnam, but you have to realize during the Vietnam War, the fight was a whole lot fairer than it is now. A whole lot fairer, and the support globally for the United States was much weaker than it is now. So we were in a stronger position in the late 60s and early 70s to bring about radical revolutionary change than we are now. We're in a worse position. There's a lot more reactionary changes that have replaced what we had then, and a lot of people have been killed. A lot of people have lost their spirit. Some of them have lost their mind. And I'm always getting mail about some Black Panther who's either deathly ill or has passed away. Some are in jail, some are free. Some of them I'm related to. They went to jail and they got out. Some of you might know, but very few of you do probably, about Geronimo. Geronimo Pratt was one of the, how many people know who is Geronimo Pratt? Okay, he was the defense minister for the Los Angeles Black Panther Party after the murder of John Huggins and Bunchy Carter on the UCLA campus after a student meeting. I mean, it was a clear, straight-up setup. to kill them. And that was in January of 1969. It was like a few weeks after Eldridge Cleaver, who had been arrested in a shootout 2 days after Martin Luther King's assassination, when the whole country was in flames. He was arrested. Bobby Hutton, the Young Panther with him, was killed. And he had gone to, as a parole violator, he'd gone back to prison. But stranger things have happened, but he did actually get out on bail. Why? Because when he went to argue, his lawyer went to argue for his being able to be released, the adult authority, which controls prisoners, sent no one. No one to discuss it. So the judge said, well, I've only heard one side. I have to rule on this side. He's out on bail. People couldn't believe it. Eldridge Cleaver, no policeman was killed, but a panther was killed. But he got out, and he was actually a candidate for president on the Peace and Freedom Party ticket, so he went around campaigning. His campaign was not successful. And instead of returning to prison when his bail time expired, he left the country. He ended up in Havana. I was supposed to join him, but I never managed to get there. Not because I didn't try. I did try. It wasn't that easy in 1968. I'm sorry, this is 1969. It wasn't that easy in 1969 to go to Cuba. He got there on a freighter from Montreal that was run by Cubans. But I never got there because by the time I was trying to get there, he had antagonized the Cubans, and the Cubans antagonized him so much, they said, well, look, we'll put you on a plane and send you to Algeria, and you can go meet your wife and bring her back with you. Well, he didn't actually want to come back. I went to Algeria to get a plane. I didn't know anything about Algeria. I was only going there to get a plane called Aeroflot, which is a Soviet airline that goes from Moscow, Algiers to Havana. You couldn't travel to Cuba from the United States at that time. So I was on my way to Algeria to get this plane, and right before I got on the plane to go to Algiers from Paris, I got a message. It says, when you get to Algiers, wait, Eldridge will be there. And he came in a Cuban passport with a Cuban name secretly. And that was the beginning of what became later the international section of the Black Panther Party. So our struggle continued. But we were welcomed to the Pan-African Cultural Festival, the first Pan-African Cultural Festival, along with all other kinds of liberation movements, because liberation was a part of the culture of Africa. Bouhari Boumediene, who was the president of Algeria, had hosted, Algeria is hosting the first Pan-African Cultural Festival and bringing cultural activists from all over and liberation movements from all over. And the Black Panther Party was actually invited. What they didn't know is that we had some Black Panthers right here secretly in their country. So we were waiting for the invitation. We got the invitation. We waited for it to start. When it was public, Eldridge could come out publicly. I was there. And then the story continues. But what I was conveying to you is that this era which Che Guevara died and so many children died and so much trauma was happening in the Vietnam era, so many people were killed. Some of them right here in Chicago that you know and you'll never forget. No one will ever forget, none of us who knew the murder of Fred Hampton. You can't. But that era is gone. There's a whole nother generation. They have a lot of examples to choose from. They have a bigger problem than we did, because they don't have the Vietnamese kicking butt of Sam. They really don't. That made a huge difference, not only here, but around the world, and how people responded to us. In particular, how the Vietnamese responded to us when we got to Algeria. Oh, they loved it. They loved meeting Black Panthers. We had met them in different conferences. The Vietnamese were very human, very passionate, very gentle in the way we met them. I mean, I don't think they were gentle on the battlefield, but so that's just a small window into what happened to somebody who said, I want to be a revolutionary. Thank you very much.
For a few minutes, have a seat.
Okay.
And then we'll open up to questions. Would you like some water?
Yes. As you can tell, I could have talked much longer.
We'll see what we can do about that. So I think, one of the things that you said that was striking is that the movement for justice never ends. But it's also the case that you said that young people today have a much harder world to live in, a much harder environment. Just to use one question, you ended up by talking about the Vietnamese. I remember when my wife went up to Vancouver and met all these Vietnamese women at a women's conference. Where do we look for allies today?
Ourselves. That's right. Where are our allies?
Ourselves. We look for our allies here, right here in America. And a lot of people coming to America from all over the world. What's so intriguing is, I've been teaching on various campuses, and I don't know, when I have students, I don't know where their parents are from. I don't know whether they have an African name because they're from Africa, or they have an African name because their parents are activists. I mean...
My kids have that problem.
Yeah, because they don't look any different.
Right.
Oh, I will say, though, maybe some of the African students are more careful with their studying than that.
Not my children with the African names.
No, I'm saying the Africans. I'm sorry. I shouldn't have said that. I take it back.
So one of the things that's very different today is the way that technology is used by both the state, by corporations, and by activists. You described the watch line, and I've forgotten all about those.
I just imagine most people here have never even heard of it.
So what advice do you have to young activists in the BYP 100, to Black Lives Matter, and to We Charge
Children? Well, keep fighting. Keep organizing, keep fighting. One organization may or may not work. Go to the next one until you get to the one that actually works for you. But keep your friends close and watch your enemies. The problem is, you don't always know who's who. I will never forget being in a conference, what was it called? The Social Forum, US Social Forum. They had a meeting in Atlanta. And I was on a panel about the San Francisco Eight, which was a group of former Panthers and activists in San Francisco who were charged with a whole host of crimes. It was the most insane indictment I've ever seen. These people who ever wrote it, they couldn't write they just couldn't write. They charged them with stuff that had already happened, charged them with stuff that somebody had already served. I mean, it was atrocious, but it didn't matter. They got them behind bars, these eight former Black Panthers, et cetera. And so the panel was about the San Francisco Eight. One of their attorneys, well, one of their legal advisors was on the panel. I was on it. Cynthia McKinney was on it. Somebody else. And we were talking about that case. So right before I go sit on the panel, some people from the Green Party. Remember the Green Party?
Yeah.
Any Green Party people here? You're sort of a green person. You don't want to admit it. Okay. Yeah, sort of. Well, anyway, so Green Party was going to have a presidential candidate that year. And Cynthia McKinney was the person that many of the Green Party in California wanted to be their candidate. But Elaine Brown, who actually was connected to Atlanta, I don't know if she was still living in Atlanta, she also wanted to be the presidential candidate for the Green Party. So I'm there, I'm just at this conference, and some people come up and ask me questions, some white-haired people from Michigan or something. They asked me if I was supporting Elaine Brown for the Green Party president. I don't know what I said. I probably looked at them like they were out of their mind. But I just said, no, I wouldn't do that, or something like that. Anyway, I tell you that because maybe 2 years down the line, I get sued by Elaine Brown. For what? What did she sue me for? Inflicting emotional distress, doing something else, doing something this, calling her names, whatever, whatever. Because, I'm trying to figure out why. Why? I don't even remember why she sued me. It was had to do with the fact that, I know what it was. It was email. The person who was the Green Party activist in Atlanta had sent me an email. And I had sent it to Cynthia McKinney. And she said, well, blah, blah, blah. And I think I sent it to Geronimo. And he sent me back a long statement. But the way email looks, the long text that Geronimo wrote, because he was responding to me, my name is at the top. So Elaine Brown read that email, and she sued me for defamation of character. She sued me for this. She sued me for that, and intentional infliction of emotional distress, because what was said by Geronimo about her? He lived in Louisiana. I lived in Atlanta. She lived somewhere. But she sued me in Atlanta. She never even sued him. She never even served him any papers. And when he read about the suit, he laughed. Anyway, these are insidious little things that people do to waste time and waste money. And you wouldn't even know what's going on, but it drags you down. Drags you down, and that's a kind of little petty, stupid, insidious things that will happen when a movement, I think, is kind of off track. That's my opinion.
Okay, we're going to open it up to the audience. Please line up in a single line in the center aisle. And I've been asked to ask you to keep your, ask questions, don't make statements, and keep your questions brief so as many people as possible can engage with our speaker.
How long do we get to stay here? About 45 minutes. For Q&A? Uh-huh. We got plenty of time.
Welcome, and thank you for all that you've done.
Thank you.
You look just like my sister.
I look like your sister?
Oh, yeah.
We may be related?
My real sister.
That's what I meant.
And my other sister. But anyway,
we don't know who our relatives are because they tell us lies about who's daddy.
Yeah, that's right.
Or they tell us nothing.
Did you know Ella Baker and Joanne Chesimard? And what do you think of? Who do you look up today?
Well, Joanne is named Asada Shakur.
Well, I'm going to do that because I remember they called her the mother hen of the Black Liberation Army.
Well,
they
didn't call her a hen.
But let me shut up. But anyway, what did you think of them? What was your contact with them? And who do you look up to today?
I guess the people I look up to are probably dead people, in the sense that I looked up to people at a time when they were alive. I looked up to Jim Foreman. I admired him immensely. I worked directly with Stokely Carmichael. I admired Eldridge Cleaver's writing. After a while, I didn't look up to him. He was too cantankerous. But he's an ex-convict and had post-traumatic stress disorder, which I didn't understand. We didn't know about all of those things then. I mean, we didn't know the names of them. And so, who do I look up to now? I think it is. It's people who've passed away. You know, I admire Ella Baker immensely. I mean, when I go back and read what she did and I look at her pictures and I see the documentary about her, I mean, she's extraordinary. Asada's younger than me. It's hard for me to look up to people who are younger than me. I mean, I can admire them, but, you know, listen, how many of you people in this room have heard that I went to Cuba? I've heard it too. I never went. I read it in the paper. In fact, I was sitting in New York reading the New York Times, and it says, Kathleen Cleaver has hijacked a plane to Cuba. I said, damn. I called them up. I said, I am here, Riverside Drive, in New York, and you better put it in the paper. I'm not hijacking a plane to Cuba. There was a Black Panther whose name was Akili, who hijacked a plane with his wife to Canada. In fact, she didn't know where they were going. She was asleep. She wakes up in Havana. And how do I know this? Because Akili and Gwen Patterson came to Algiers for the Pan-African Cultural Festival. So there's, you know, this is a lot of chaos, and I looked up to people who had made revolutions
that I didn't know. I mean, like, I looked up to Ben Bella. I looked up to Patrice Lumumba. I looked up to these people who had transformed the world as far as I knew. But that's why I said not too many of them are alive.
Good evening. Did you find that any of the men in the movement were threatened or intimidated by you? And if so, how did you deal with that?
Well, if they were intimidated by me, I didn't know it. Okay. But then I'm kind of, what's the right word, cantankerous. So even if I did know it, I wouldn't care.
Wow. Thank you. I am so pleased to be here and hear all you're making history come alive for me.
Oh, thank you so much. Thank you.
Because that was during my, you know, heyday as well. But this is my question to you. I was wondering, with all the black-on-black crime that we have here all over this country, as well as all the things we're faced with, same thing as what you were faced with back in the day, but now it's so worse because we have this black-on-black stuff. Where would you suggest young people focus their energy in terms of what should we fight first? We don't know what to do. You know, because we've got the black-on-black stuff, we've still got the police.
Well, wait a minute. The black-on-black stuff is not just because it's black. It's manufactured.
Okay.
It's a manufactured situation.
Okay.
None of these little children that end up with guns running around shooting other children, none of them started out that way.
Right.
Somebody dropped the ball.
Mm-hmm.
Frequently, they're mommy and daddy.
Right.
I'm not blaming mommy and daddy. But what I'm trying to say is the social inequality
mm-hmm.
of this society is
mm-hmm.
insane. The willingness
mm-hmm.
to allow children to suffer economically, to suffer because they don't have enough to eat, to suffer horrible schools, to suffer violence and brutality at the hands of their parents. I'm sorry.
Yes.
That's not going to help us, change the world. That's destructive. And those kind of situations are perpetuated over and over and over. What is it, the argument that was on television with Bill Clinton and the Black Lives Matter protesters
mm-hmm.
about the 1994 crime bill?
Mm-hmm.
Mass incarceration. Look,
yeah.
if you look at the statistics of imprisonment, up until 1971,
mm-hmm.
the numbers of black kids and the numbers of white kids that were in prison were more or less similar, even though there's way more white people.
Mm-hmm.
But there was no mass incarceration.
Right.
Nixon said he was going to bring law and order. And
mm-hmm.
Nixon discovered,
we
don't have the right probability to arrest all these kids. They began, Nixon and then Bush began a campaign of changing federal laws, particularly drug laws, to set up black kids and black neighborhoods and create mass incarceration.
Yes.
All right, so those are the pigs that you need to be worrying about, the ones you created, not the ones who suffered.
So you think we're moving in the right direction at this point in terms of the movement?
The movement should be against the people in authority who are creating this insane prison society. I mean, that's my opinion.
I agree.
All right. Thank you.
Hi, Ms. Cleaver. It is an honor to be here and to speak with you.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here. So as you were talking about before, how black activist groups are kind of met with a lot more resistance and vitriol from the forces that be, what do you think would be a way of gaining knowledge on how to come about a different way of seeking that liberation? Would it be pursuing, you know, degrees in law? Would it be becoming more active in politics?
Degrees in law, okay. I'm not gonna tell you how to get liberation. I'm gonna tell you how to lock people up, basically.
Okay.
I mean, it'll help you think. I will say, I have a degree in law, but I was 39, I think, when I got the degree in law. So I already kind of knew how to think.
Mm-hmm.
But it helps you understand what's going on in the criminal justice system. But it's stacked. So no, I don't think if you want to become an effective organizer, an effective change maker, you should study successful movements for change. That's not what they teach you in law school.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't mean that it's bad to be a lawyer. Lawyers are good analysts, and one of the most brilliant lawyers was Charles Gary, and he did a lot to help all the Black Panthers who kept getting arrested and going to jail, but he didn't help enough. I mean, this is what I hear from the parents of the kids that he didn't help. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Charles Gary, yeah. Because their son is in prison where somebody else's son gets out. So, I think it is an issue of solidarity in the community. I think we need much stronger communities. We need stronger families. Mm-hmm. So if we need to study anything, it's how to stick together. We used to know that. Because we didn't have any choice. We didn't have any support system if it wasn't ourselves. Mm-hmm. I grew up at that time. I didn't understand that that's what it was. But looking back, I say, oh, you know, yeah, everybody we knew, everybody we lived beside, everybody we worked with, they were all Black people. They were Black people at a college campus, or they were Black people in the town, or they were, in fact, in Alabama, I don't think I ever saw white people because you had to get a car to go downtown, and if I didn't go with my mother shopping or something, I mean, so it was like, we lived in kind of a Black world. Mm-hmm. And that's not true anymore. And we lived in a world that didn't have any mass incarceration. They had a whole lot of ways of jacking up Black people, but not this. This is demonic.
Thank you.
Well, you could go work with one of those projects that gets people who are not guilty out of prison, but it takes forever. What's it called, the Innocence Project? I was thinking, suppose it was 100 Innocence Projects. There's only one. And they did a lot of work here in Chicago. And they kept, well, if they did more work, they'd find more people. I mean, they'd be able to service more people. I'm sorry, they'd be able to service more people. So there's a huge problem with improper and mass incarceration. But, you know, I mean, when you work on that, then you just, that's what you do. You don't have any time or energy to do anything else. So maybe you need sections of working against incarceration and other sections, so like a huge, major corporate structure of liberation. Doesn't make sense, does it, Wanda? When I meant corporate, I meant departments. That's what I meant. I didn't mean having money like a big corporation. What I meant, your department of resisting mass imprisonment, resisting bad nutrition, resisting food deserts, resisting violence against women. You know, we need all these kinds of things.
Ms. Cleaver, it's a breathtaking opportunity to meet you. I'm going to try not to cry. Thank you for all that you've done.
Please don't cry.
I'm also part of the Black Youth Project 100 here in Chicago, but I also belong to a group called Asada's Daughters, where we teach young...
Oh, tell me about that. I don't
yes.
know about that one.
We teach young Black girls. We're a multi-generational organization where we teach young Black girls about liberation movements. And we, this semester, are teaching our girls about the Black Panther 10-point Party program.
Excellent.
And I just wanted to ask you, what would be some advice you would have for young Black girls who express their Black girl magic unapologetically in this city, who are fighting for our liberation? They teach us weekly as their mentors, but they are mentors to us. So what would you say for our organization as Asada's Daughters as we continue to fight for our people? Because it's our duty, obviously.
Well, I think more people should know about you. I think you should have public exposure. I think you should have some open meetings. Invite, go to a school. Or I don't know how to do this, but let's say, what neighborhood are you working in?
So we're on the south side of Chicago.
Okay, we have a lot of schools on the south side of Chicago. Mm-hmm. You should find a teacher or a principal who's willing to allow your girls to come and talk to classes at their school so they can tell them what they're doing mm-hmm. and pass the word and enhance the participation. That would what I would suggest.
Thank you so much, and we love you. Thank you.
Thank you so much for doing all that you have done for us. My question is that, do you feel that we will see any meaningful change under our present unregulated capitalist system in this country?
No. I mean, once you say the unregulated capitalist system,
that's
kind of how we get stopped everywhere you turn, particularly on the level of income. Okay,
yes.
In 1966-67, when I went out to San Francisco, Eldridge Cleaver had a job at Ramparts, He was paid whatever they pay writers. He had an apartment of one, what do you call it? A studio. It's all in one room with a kitchen.
Yes.
In San Francisco on Castro Street, which is a little hill that it goes into the, what's the name of that street? It's near the Haight-Ashbury. Anyway, his rent was $90 a month.
Hmm.
So if you have to pay $90 a month to live, you can do a lot of activism. But if you have to pay $900 a month to live, then you can do less activism. Right. If you want to buy a house and get a mortgage and you have to keep your... I mean, it's just the economics of survival or prospering. Well, I don't know which one it is, whether we prosper or we survive.
Right.
Inhibit the area and the arena of activism, unfortunately.
Mm-hmm.
So... In the Bay Area, the way things would happen is because it was less expensive during the 60s, you'd have people who lived in a group, and one of them would work and cover the rent, and the others would be activists, and it'd be the turn of somebody else. And so there was a lot of collaboration among activists or working together, but the cost of living was so much more reasonable.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's insane now. I can't figure out how people manage. You know, I have to get a lot of different sources. I have to have a lot of different pockets to get money from to keep everything even keel. Right. And then it doesn't, and I just don't answer the phone when the people call me up.
Right. One other thing. Today we see we have a lot of dissatisfaction on the right, and we have a lot of dissatisfaction on the left. So where is this going? Bernie is talking about a political revolution. The Occupy Wall Street movement, I believe, is still alive. So where do you see us going here now with this satisfaction, extreme dissatisfaction on both sides, left and right? So where are we, what's going to happen? In your opinion, what's going to happen to us in this country? Black folks, white folks, rich folks, not including the 0.1% that's really calling everything.
Oh, you want him to ask a question?
Oh, okay, sure.
He did ask a question. What's going to happen?
Yeah.
I could say something very blunt, but I think I better not.
Say it, say it.
I don't know.
All of us, I guess. Thank you, Sister Cleaver, for being here. And for lending your candor.
I'll tell you this. I like what Bernie Sanders says. And the fact that I like what he says probably is a guarantee that he's not even going to get anywhere with his program. Because people who like what he says like the externally different and focus on different values. He has different values than the other candidates. And he values change. He values social equality. I'm just stunned that his campaign is still going on. I mean, I'm impressed. I love it. I particularly like the fact that he's older than me and he's actually out there running for president. That's impressive. But you can be sure that the system... or the shitsum, as a friend of mine calls it. He's not going to be able to get the Democratic Party nomination. Not this time, and if he doesn't get it this time, there won't be another time, I don't think. But at least he's energized and activated a huge swath of young people, which is great. So maybe they will continue. I mean, I'm impressed that more and more young people pay attention to electoral politics. That's it. Maybe that shows how conservative our country's become, that that's what people think they can do. Well, you can do it. You won't get arrested for voting. Not normally, anyway.
When you consider one of the better routes to rebuilding or making our communities more wholesome, separatism, segregation, versus integration for equality.
Well, first of all, we don't have any integration. That's a mythological word.
Thank you.
So, and no one ever uses it. You'd have to tell people, you have to be a certain age to even know about that word.
Mm-hmm. So, to that point, as we see the disparity in more and more of our systems, do you push, should our people be pushing more towards equality within the systems like education, banking, and the like, or having our own black schools, our own, what do you think is the most effective route, our own versus trying to push for equality?
Okay, I grew up as a young child in Tuskegee, and we had our own. We had our own university, and we had our own, although Tuskegee was a state-supported institution, it was only black people. And we had big pictures of Booker T. Washington, statue of Booker T. Washington, and the statue of Martin Luther, the scientists, George Washington Carver. We had no need to look elsewhere for inspiration. We were fortunate in that the university had a swimming pool in their gym, so we could go swimming. Somebody said our parents were so careful with their children in that town that we didn't even know it was a problem. Because we could go to the movies on campus, we could go to the swimming pool on campus, we could go to the little parties at our friend's house. We had the teachers, well, I think this was a good idea, but the teachers all knew each other and all the parents knew the teachers. So you really couldn't get away with too much at school. And it's very different now. It's very, very, very different. I think we're experiencing it. From what I read in the newspapers and what I observe, social disintegration on a massive scale in black communities. And these are people, we're descendants of people that worked really, really, really hard to make something of themselves. Like the parents, not the parents, I think the grandparents of the man who started the NAACP Legal Defense Fund. You know, they were runaway slaves. They want to run away to get to another place. So when you see people who are outstanding and you go back and see people in their families did things to make sure their children and their descendants would get somewhere. That meant they had the gumption, they had the energy, they thought about it. They were lucky. But I don't see enough of that. Okay. Maybe there wasn't that much at the time, and just those are the stories I read, and I like those stories. So I read about those people over and over. But we did have this tremendous sense that we could do better. We as a community could do better. And we could hang together. And we could change things. But I don't know. I don't know whether that sentiment is as widespread as it is. It? It's still here? All right, then we can rock.
Hi, I'm Asia. Nice to meet you and actually be here. My question, I heard you talk a lot about how a lot of people you started the movement with, some of them fell ill mentally, some of them were incarcerated, some of them died. I just wonder, because you're here and you're like speaking so eloquently and like you're still like mentally here, and I just wonder what you did. I'm sorry.
It's a front. I'm okay. Really spaced out.
I just want to know.
That's why I carry all my stuff all the time.
I just want to know what advice you have to people fighting for liberation in the movement to stay mentally sound. Like, how do you preserve your mental health? How did you preserve your mental health? Because I think in the African American community, that mental health is a thing where we're like, oh, you're crazy.
Wait a minute. You say preserve. You keep it, but preserve, I don't know, it comes and goes.
Okay.
I mean, that's what you have to understand. Everybody is not cool all the time.
Yeah.
You know, people lose it. Some people lose it and never come back. Yeah. Some people lose it and come back. Some people never lose it because they never did anything to drive them crazy. They're very passive people. But I don't have any friends like that. I do have some relatives like that. So, I don't know. I mean, one of the things about the United States is it's place where people actually think up and create adventures for themselves. Mm-hmm. They're adventurous, they're innovative, and what did Eldridge used to say? This is somebody you'd be surprised to say this. He said, that old Yankee Doodle Dandy can-do spirit. You know? Mm-hmm. He liked that. No, it's corny, isn't it? But he liked it because it's sort of like, okay, we're going to figure this out and we're going to solve this problem. And he had other little things he would say that people didn't care for that much, like, ready or not, here we come. We have a sense of humor. We don't have a lot of money. I mean, I think it's a time of taking stock of what are the strongest points in our communities and what are the weakest points. And the weakest points probably add up a lot. And this is a drain on our community and on our progress, which in a right-wing, reactionary, capitalist world, this is not good. Mm-hmm. Not good, because if you're fragile, you're going to be suffering even more than if you have resources. And so then there's a what did I just read? I just happened to have seen, I was flipping through something. It must have been on the internet, or maybe it was even on, I think it was on the internet. But it was a story about, what's the lady's name who ran Essence for years? Susan Taylor. It was a story about Susan Taylor and how she had struggled for so long with depression. I said, Susan Taylor? Well, I know she always looked the same in all her pictures. I said, how does she manage to look exactly the same? She braid her hair every day? I don't know. I mean, we have a lot of resilience in our community, and we have a lot of impatience. Mm-hmm. So young people, you have more impatience, and old people, we have more resilience. So maybe we need collective to work together on this.
Thank you.
Yeah. First off, it's an honor to be here and to see you, and I've heard you speak. Two great women in one school year. I saw Angela Davis speak at Purdue last fall, so that was awesome.
Good for you.
Thank you. First off, being mixed and also having like my Instagram and all that flooded with the foolishness from the HOTEP and the Nawabian pages.
You're a popular guy.
I guess, I don't know. But because of my mixedness, I usually look out and I'm not centered towards just, the Black community, which did raise me. I'm very in support of solidarity with other non-Black people of color, such as the Palestinians, who did lend their aid and advice around the time of Michael Brown's murder. So I just want to know, what's your opinion on reaching out to other non-Black people of color for solidarity? Are you in support of
it? The Black community is full of non-Black people of color. I mean, we are. It's just recently, I remember going to, I think it was in law school at the time, because I think I learned this in New Haven. There was a term I never heard. I mean, it's true. There are a lot of people who are so-called, who are called Black people, who are what you would call now biracial. But when my father was growing up, they didn't have any biracials. He was a colored man. He didn't particularly like being a colored man, because it wasn't that much fun back in the Nadir, that era. They call it the Nadir, 1911, that's when he was born. But he worked very, very hard. His uncle lives here in Chicago. He was a mailman. His name was William Shepherd. And I realized, there's probably every Black family in America at least has one relative in Chicago on the South Side. And a lot of them worked in the post office. So, at that time. So what I'm trying to say is we have a phenomenally resilient community. And it's in recent time that somebody would say, well, I'm biracial or I'm mixed or whatever. We couldn't say that. They didn't care. Walter White was the head of the NAACP. He had white hair, white skin, white eyeglasses, white shirt. You can't get more white than Walter White. But he was a Negro. In fact, at that era, there were people who preferred being called colored. Why? Because colored means that there's mix, I never figured out why they wanted to be called colored until I looked, oh, wow, that's why they want to be colored. They didn't like the Black stuff. So, I mean, I just, I don't know. It just seems like people should function within the context of a community. Stop worrying about what your color is. You know, because it doesn't make that much difference, particularly if you live in North Africa or the Asia, Middle East. When I went to North Africa, I didn't understand how conservative Algeria was. Well, I didn't know anything about Algeria because I thought I was going to Havana. But I get there in my big afro and my little short mini dresses and boots and big ankles. I mean, that was a rather provocative look for Algeria. I mean, the women there were walking around, you know, all wrapped up with the thing across their face. So I didn't realize, one of our my comrades who was there, a young lady from Kansas City, who was 19 when she came to Algiers pregnant with her husband, Pete O'Neill, who was the leader of the Kansas City Black Panthers. They were fugitives. They ended up in Algiers. And Charlotte has said, oh my God, I am so embarrassed. Now that she realizes how people looked at her with her big hoop earrings and short skirts. And I mean, the things that we thought were normal, they thought were offensive. That's probably not true anymore. They started doing a lot of those offensive things and the women stopped wearing all that crap, at least the last time I was there. But I mean, don't get hung up on superficial things. And try to function in principled manners on real projects. And then if you work hard at that, you won't have time to be worried about what color you are, in my opinion.
Thank you.
Good evening, Ms. Cleaver. My name is Mary. I'm a first year here in the college, and I want to say it's an honor to have you.
Thank you.
But this year at the Super Bowl, Beyonce performed.
Oh, Lord have mercy. I'm sorry. I have managed to avoid discussing this ridiculous video. Go on. What is your question?
I mean, I was just going to ask for your take on her performance, but.
I hate it. I didn't really hate it. I was kind of lathering. I said I hated it, but that is actually not true. I heard people talking about it and asking me about it, and I didn't know what they were asking about. So the wife of Stanley Nelson, who's a documentary filmmaker who made Black Panther's Vanguard of the Revolution, she sent me the link so I could watch the Super Bowl performance. Well, my mouth dropped open. What? And I got back to her. I said, that's borderline pornographic. And she said, you don't watch too many music videos, do you? I said, no, I like B.B. King. I like blues. I mean, we don't have music videos in that music. Maybe they do, but I don't look at them. I like to listen. Music is something I want to listen to, and I never listen to Beyonce, ever. So I was insulted in a way because she had these booty shakers with the fishnet stockings and berets like they're supposed to be Panthers. This is insult. All the Panther women I know said they hated it, and the men, they really like it.
Thank you. That was great. How are you tonight?
I'm okay.
Good. I'm from Black Lives Matter, Gary, Indiana. And,
good for you.
There it is. And, I guess I had two quick questions. One may be quick. The first is just purely your opinion. Do you think that anybody can achieve freedom and liberation in a capitalist system?
As an individual, perhaps. As a family, perhaps. As a community, no.
Okay.
Because you have too much of a range, there's too many restrictions. But then what happens to the larger group is they accept the limitations.
Right.
That's what Black people have been doing for a long time. You know, look, I teach a seminar that's called The Law of Citizenship and Race, and there's a story that I use from, what year is this? This is in the 1930s, and it's a quote in the Christian Century. The readings are quoting something in the Christian Century
about a particular case, and it's somewhere in the north. I can't think of where it is. It's maybe Illinois, somewhere. I mean, it's a backwards place, but it's not in the deep south. Okay, so anyway, the sheriff sees these men, black men, sitting on their porch because they're on strike. They're members of the tenant farmers union.
Okay.
So they're not going to work. So he gets really pissed, drives up in his car, get in here, boy, I'm taking you down to the jail. Then he arrests them. Why? Because they're, what's the right word? Loitering. Vagrant, right. And there's a movement afoot at that time in the 1930s to challenge this type of treatment, and particularly the people who want to organize unions and help the black farmers, et cetera, et cetera. So Pritchard actually goes to court. He is charged with kidnapping them or something like that. Well, I don't remember the exact charges. Mm-hmm. He gets convicted of something and has to pay a fine, and it blows his mind. What?
Right.
You know, like, he can't just round up black people and tell them what to do? What's the world coming to? I mean, that's his attitude. And then the Christian Century comment is, well, and this is in the 1930s, okay? Slavery ended in 1865,
kinda.
Supposedly. I mean, on paper. It says, well, slavery is too much a part of the American culture to be eliminated. It's just there. I want to tear the book up when people say things like that. But, well, so, given that that was true in the 1930s, I hope that there aren't people who think they can just go round up people and throw them in there. But I know they live here in Chicago.
Right.
Okay?
Right.
In fact, when I came here, I had two articles that I clipped out of the New York Times, Chicago's racist courts and something else. It's like, look. This isn't the South, but this is one of the most racist parts of the country you can find.
Absolutely. Yep.
Yeah. Georgia people are, look, Jimmy Carter came from Georgia. He was a good president. anyway. They didn't keep him too long, you might notice.
Did anybody in the party have a sense that maybe they were trying to tackle too many things, that they weren't centralized enough? No?
We were too young to think we were trying to tackle too many things. Anybody in your right mind can say, yeah, you're going to have a revolution in America? Oh. The Vietnamese were very impressed with the Black Panthers. They loved the Black Panthers. I'm not quite sure why they loved us. One of them said, because Big Man, there was a Panther named Big Man, who's really big and dark and impressive. Ooh, that's power, you know. We met Vietnamese, and they're small. Most Vietnamese are fairly small, slender people. But they're great fighters. In fact, I knew a photographer, a French woman who was a photographer, had been in Vietnam. She said, they love to fight. So there's a lot of black people who love to fight. The problem is they fight the wrong people, usually.
Absolutely, yep.
So we need to get our love to fight with the right focus.
Yeah. And lastly,
and that takes a while. Seems like it hadn't happened long. I mean, it happens a little bit by little bit, but then it slips back.
I'm sitting next to Geronimo Pratt's nephew back
which
there.
One?
He said
which
he
one?
Said he wanted to holler at
well,
you afterwards.
What's his name?
Paul Pratt.
Paul.
Wait, where's your hand, Paul?
Hey. Hey, how you doing? My grandson's his cousin. Coyote Jaga. He's 13 years old now. Yes. That's my daughter's son, by Geronimo. That was his last wife, my daughter.
Hi, my name is Christopher, and on behalf of the Rainbow Push Coalition, I just want to thank you for being here today. We really appreciated what you had to say.
Thank you.
My question is, what is your advice to the younger generation on how to effectively use their talents and their energy to create more economic opportunities and policy development that'll last more generations?
Well, you said young people and you said economic opportunities.
Right.
Usually the people who are creating economic opportunities are a little older.
Okay.
They have a position in society, they may have access to resources, they may own a company. Mm-hmm. So when you say young people, they have a lot of energy and they have, what's the right word? Aspirations for the future.
Okay.
But I don't know how many have the technical skills to create economic development. I mean, Some do. But I can't say young people go out there and start businesses and start factories and invent things. So like the little boy, the little Arab boy in Texas who invented a clock and he was so proud of himself, ended up in handcuffs for making a bomb. Mm-hmm. Well, his parents took him to Qatar, where they're respected, and his intelligence is going to be rewarded. There's a lot of things that people can say. When I was a college dropout, I dropped out twice. This is, I think, the first time. I got a job in Washington, D.C., working in something called the Community Relations Service. That was an agency created under the Civil Rights Act. And what the Community Relations Service did was go into areas where there was riots or trouble, et cetera, and study. Like, I remember, because I typed up the reports. There'd been a big riot in Cleveland in a neighborhood called Huff. And so they would go and they would write up all these little things and write and talk about it and say this and say that and the other. And then I would type up the reports in triplicate. And so I was learning a lot about what was going on. But look, what is the government doing sending people to observe? You know, this is very odd. In fact, one of the people I got to be very close friends with was a law student who had that as a summer job. And he would go and they'd observe. They just observe, write reports. So it seems to me that that is not the appropriate, that's not what we need. We don't need reports. I mean, the government wants to report. But what we need is institutional changes. We need access to resources. We need people to have education, to have employment, to have goals, to have health, so they can enhance our communities. But it seems like we're getting all the opposites. Not 100%. But so now when you say young people, you have to solve this problem. That's a lot. That's a lot. What is it that young people are good at?
Technology?
No, yeah, probably, yeah. I'm not good at technology. So I don't. No, but what I'm saying is struggle has to be multi-generational. Mm-hmm. You need to be connected to people of different age groups and different skill sets and different races in different communities. Now, the question is, how do you structure that? Here, I think they call it the Rainbow Coalition. Wanda, didn't you have a rainbow coalition here?
Yeah. Yeah.
That's all right.
Yeah, that's.
He's in it?
Yeah.
No, they're not in that one. The one I'm talking about, he's too young.
Okay.
Well, no, it's a Push Rainbow Coalition is Jesse. Rainbow Coalition is Fred Hampton.
All right.
Young patriots, young lords. You know, the lords were Latino. They were not all. You know why the Puerto Ricans got noticed most? Because the other Latinos said, well, y'all don't have a flag. So you could have the young lords, and you can have that flag, because we all got flags. But I think that the demonstrated ability of black people, or whatever, however you want to describe the descendants of Africans living here, because there are a lot of different colors, you know, striped people, mixed people, biracial people, whatever. I just like the word black people. It doesn't mean the color, it means the ancestry.
Right.
Are creative and inventive and always come up with something that you never thought of, including Beyonce. But we have to have a sense of, what's the right word? Possibility. Like the Black Panthers, we said, we're gonna do this or we're gonna die trying. It wasn't like you can't do it. No, we didn't talk about we can't. Never. It's like, we're gonna do it. If we don't do it, we still gonna try and do it. And we got people in prison since 1969 who are still surviving because they would not stop trying. You know, there's people who went to trial here. There are people who've been murdered here. But that didn't stop the momentum of the movement. So I think that's what we, in my opinion, I mean, I'm biased because I think movements are great, and they give people a tremendous sense of accomplishment. Even if you don't accomplish what you set out to, you accomplish something, and you can respect yourself, and people can acknowledge that you actually tried to make a difference. Whether you succeeded is another question.
We have 5 minutes, so we can, everybody in line, can, if they keep their questions short, we'll be able to answer, to have both of you finish.
So okay, just, maybe you somebody should, how many, okay, 5 minutes?
Yeah, just give us your question, both of your questions, then you'll have the final word.
All right, so I was wondering, how did you navigate the education system? Because I know college can be just honestly like a very soul-crushing place.
I dropped out. That's how I navigated it.
But what advice do you have for Black women today, Black queer women? Black women today in college?
Okay, the next, I'm gonna write it down. And then your question.
My name is Robert Campbell, I'm from Gary, Indiana, and I would like for you to recognize the Illinois chapter of the Black Panther Party. I'm a former member. I think we have some here in the
third row. Wanda. Yes.
Wanda, and then there's the communication secretary.
Ann. Oh, I didn't recognize you. I'm so sorry.
And
I know you are.
Yeah, this group here, Wanda was the one that really organized our Breakfast for Children program. And kept.
Stand up, Wanda, so we can see who they're talking about.
I mean, I did a phenomenal job. I was one of the ones that helped to initiate, but they took over and did a phenomenal job. Ann has always did a phenomenal job.
Because they're phenomenal women.
People, no, we're phenomenal human beings. young lady, are you a human being? Thank you. I own up to it.
But he's older.
That's right. And I have a lot of respect for women. I have a mother. My mother passed away. I got grandchildren. I have a wife. I've been married 40-something years. So I respect women. You know, I don't use no profanity. I don't call them out of their names, okay? The question is that you were on to something when you was talking about the importance of the family structure. You were really on to something, because when you have a strong family structure, you end up with strong communities, strong children, strong individuals. And back during slavery, when our people used to sing that old song, "Sometimes I Feel Like a Motherless Child."
Well, we need to get to your question, because we only have two.
Hey, I'm out of it. You were on point.
Oh, you just want to compliment me? You didn't have a question?
No.
No. Okay, cool.
Hey. Matter of fact.
Power to the people.
Matter of fact, you stimulated my thinking.
Good.
To do better. And to keep on moving forward. Thank you.
So now I have to do advice to Black women. Well, advice to Black women in college. Whatever you do, maintain your sanity. And if it requires leaving, leave. I left several times. I don't know if my sanity required it. The first time I left, it was boring. And the second time I left, it was to work in SNCC. I could do better. I could do much better than go to Barnard College, which was boring, and go across the street at the apartment of my friends from Alabama, SNCC, where I met SNCC leaders, and I ended up having a job and went down to 500 Fifth Avenue, wherever way down in the village where the SNCC office was, worked there for 6 months, and then moved to Atlanta and worked there for a few months before I met Eldridge Cleaver. So, advice to women, follow your heart. If you can get your parents to pay for it, so much the better. I don't know if they will or they won't. I mean, my parents were flexible. My parents met in college. My mother was a graduate student at the University of Michigan, and my father was a graduate student at the University of Michigan, because where they lived, my father lived in Tennessee. Right, at that time, he was in Texas. My mother lived in Virginia. They weren't allowed to go to any graduate schools. Michigan allowed Black students to attend classes. Now, you couldn't live in their dormitories, which meant black families who had extra room could rent out rooms, so there was an economic incentive there. But so the black woman has, what was it? There's something Angela Davis wrote. She says, you know, you don't need to get too, lyrical. Don't wax, this is not her words, but don't wax too lyrical about strong black women. I mean, listen, these people were impressed upon to carry double burdens, okay? And did it. But that's not something you want to be thankful for. You know, let's have some sharing of the burdens.
Okay. Thank you very much, and thank you for making this a lively evening.